Hello, everybody. This is Evan, founder and CEO of Gentatech, and we are back again with another high-level overview. If this is your first time tuning into our high-level overview series, we take different aspects of IT and simplify them as much as possible so business owners and those new to the IT world can get a grasp and understand some of these concepts. Today, we're going to be talking about DHCP, also known as Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol. And DHCP is a process of automatically assigning an IP address to hosts that connect to your network. Now, to really appreciate why this is needed, let's first take a look at how this was done before DHCP came about. Now, what would happen is you'd have a host on your network like so, and then you have to access the network configuration settings on that host itself and then assign this a static IP address like so, 192.168.1.50. That'll work. Now, this is still used today and is still very common across building out networks if a host needs a static IP address. But having this be the only way to assign IP address across a network becomes extremely problematic as that network grows. The amount of labor needed to go chase down each and every host and every separate part of the company, log on to the computer, configure a static IP address. It just takes a lot of time, and time is definitely money. So what we do now is something called Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol. It's automatic assigning via a server or a service on a layer 3 device. One other problem before we move on that this kind of really takes care of DHCP is one issue with static assignment is the host essentially owns that IP address. So let's say that we have let's say we have 5, 10, 20, maybe 80 hosts, right? And let's say we're going to go ahead and upgrade our network and we have 5, 10, 20, 80 new computers. Well, before, under the umbrella of static configuration, if we were to unplug or take away this computer, this IP address, 192.168.1.50, would permanently be married to that computer unless we deconfigured it, meaning that this IP address could no longer be used by our network because it was already taken. So you can see how that becomes a problem. Let's say we have 80 computers across the network, and then we forget to deconfigure these 80 IP addresses that we connected, and we take away those computers to upgrade them. Well, now we have 80 less IP addresses that we can use, and it really becomes a mess and, you know, doubles, quadruples, and really order of magnitudes higher amount of labor needs to be put in to get this thing handled compared to DHCP, okay? So DHCP solves this problem, and it solves this problem in a very nifty way. So we hear the term DHCP server, and in some larger networks, you still do have servers that single-handedly handle DHCP. These can be ran in Windows or Linux environments, but most of you, and these days, most people will run into DHCP as a service that's running on a layer 3 device that handles a multitude of other things like routing and firewalls and et cetera, okay? But for the purpose of this video, we're going to stick to the basics of the protocol here. So we're going to go ahead and look at a single DHCP server. And let's go ahead and name this thing here, all right? So we have a DHCP server here, okay? And in addition to this, we're going to go ahead and need a computer. So let's go ahead and grab this. This is going to be our host for this particular example. And remember, a host is just a computer as far as we're concerned today, okay? And we're going to go ahead and call this a host, all right? As a little cheat sheet here, okay, these two things do separate things under the DHCP umbrella, okay? A host is going to be responsible for requests, all right, and reception. So it's going to request and receive, okay? A DHCP server is going to be responsible for listening, okay, and assignments, all right? And this language is nowhere in the protocol itself. We're going to take a look at the exact steps of the protocol. But this is a good way to remember what side does what. So if you're a host, you're going to request and you're going to receive. If you're a DHCP server, you're going to listen and you're going to assign. Okay. Now, the DHCP process is a four-step process that includes step one, which is discover, step two, which is offer, three is request, and four is acknowledgement. And we're going to break this process down step by step to see exactly how this is done. So step one is going to start with the host because this host is going to be requesting. So a host logs on to a network. It's turned on, plugged in, whatever it may be. And what's going to do is going to send a request, okay, all the way across the network. And this request actually broadcasts across the entire network. So every host on the network hears it. Server, host, it doesn't really matter what it is. Anything plugged into the network hears it, okay? And we're just going to go ahead and call this step one, all right? And this is going to be called DHCP Discover, okay? Now, in step one, in this DHCP Discover phase, what's happening is this host is sending a broadcast message across the domain saying, hey, I need an IP address. Is anybody there that could possibly give me one, right? And within this step one message, this Discover message, it's going to put its MAC address in the message so whoever's reading it can understand who it's coming from, okay? And a good way to think about DHCP is really what this is, if there's anybody more slightly advanced watching this, is this whole process is layer two communication through the MAC address to bring this host up to a layer three arena, okay? So now, after the DHCP server has received the Discover message, it's now going to decipher that message and broadcast a DHCP offer. So it's going to send a DHCP offer. And again, this is going across the entire network, okay? All right, so this will be step two, DHCP offer, all right? And this is a message that's broadcast again. Now, this DHCP offer is actually going to contain everything needed for this host to be assigned an IP address. So that includes the actual IP address itself. That's going to include the subnet mask, the DNS server's IP information, the IP address of the default gateway, and a few other things as well, such as FTP and some other things. We won't talk about that today. But one caveat we will mention, one important parameter, is this is going to include something called the client ID. And in that client ID parameter, you're going to have the MAC address that was sent over by the host. So the host sends a Discover message with the MAC address. The DHCP server sends an offer message with that same MAC address appended in the client ID parameter. Okay. So after this is sent over here, what this host is going to do is then send back a DHCP request, okay? And this step is pretty simple here. So step three is going to be DHCP requests, and this really works just like a conversation, okay? Step one, hey, I need an IP address. Is anybody there? Step two, yes, I have an IP address for you. Would you like one? Step three, since I know somebody's there, I am officially requesting that IP address. And what's going on underneath the hood here is after the host receives a DHCP offer message, this DHCP request is going to have a parameter in the transaction ID field that essentially says, yes, I need an IP address. Will you please send one over? Okay. And it's an accept or deny is what that is. And this is going to be an accept, of course. And when that's accepted, this server is going to respond here, right? And step four is going to be the DHCP acknowledgement, okay? And the DHCP acknowledgement essentially says, hello, host, you can indeed use that information. You're good to go. All is well. Go ahead and start using it. And from that point on, the host will start using that IP address. All right, so let's review this process again. So step one, we have the DHCP Discover message. That is the host joining the network and sending a broadcast out across the entire network saying that it needs an IP address. Step two, which is really where most of the magic happens, the DHCP server configures an IP address and all the relevant information that's needed to be assigned an IP address and sends that information over in an offer. And remember, step one, a MAC address from the host will be included. And step two, in the client ID field, that MAC address will again be sent, okay? After this host receives the offer, and every host across the network will, because it's a broadcast, right? It will look at that MAC address and say, hey, that's my MAC address. This message must be for me. It'll look that over and then send an official request, right? And step three, it says, hello, I got that offer. I'm officially requesting to use a parameter sent over in step two. May I do it? And then step four, the DHCP server says, sure, you sure can do that, sends an acknowledgement back, and the host is good to go. Now, when some people first learn this process, they can say, you know, maybe there's a little bit too many steps here. Why not just say, hey, I need an IP address and send an offer back and you're good to go? Well, there's kind of a fail-safe built in here because let's say that host one sends out a discover message, okay? The server sends back an offer, all right? And then let's say now this host falls off the network. Maybe it's unplugged, maybe it crashes. Well, if it doesn't send an official request, then the process dies. So every step of this process has to be completed for the IP address to officially be assigned. So if there's a failure at any place in these steps, and there's some redundancy in here with the request and the acknowledgement, then the process will not take place. Well, that's important because if there's multiple hosts on a network and multiple requests, let's say that by the time this request is sent back, that IP address has already been assigned. Maybe this host froze or whatever it may be. The DHCP acknowledgement will fail. It'll say, no, you cannot use that. So the host will start the process over. So having this kind of fail-safe in here in this process allows many, many, many hosts across the network to be taken care of by one DHCP server without any IP conflicts being assigned, meaning a duplicate IP address to multiple hosts. Okay. Now there are a few caveats in here about how you can configure the DHCP server. And one of the important things that you can do is you can create a scope. Okay. So there's a range of IP addresses on any network. And let's look at a basic one. 192.168.1.1. So this is our network, okay? Now remember, the first bit of a network, all right, is going to be used, excuse me, the first part of a network is going to be used for the gateway, and the last is going to be used for the broadcast, okay? So if we are on network 192.168.1.1, that means we can use the IP address 192.168.1.2, okay? And then if this goes all the way to 254, we can use all the way up to 253. So 192.168.1.253, all right? So this will be our scope here, okay? Now what we can do is we can configure this DHCP server to have a particular scope for whatever reason that we want. So instead of having 200 plus IP addresses that can be assigned here, let's say we only want this thing to have the capability to assign 10. We go 192.168.1.10 all the way down to 192.168.1, and let's say, oh, come on there. There we go. Dot 20. Okay. Now, if this is the scope, throughout this entire process here, this DHCP server can only assign IP addresses within this scope here. Another thing that we can mention here are DHCP reservations. So we can set static IP addresses on hosts themselves, and we learned that at the beginning of the video. But if you don't want to do that, you can also have a workaround here, which is essentially the same thing as a static configuration, but this takes place on the server side. So what we can do is create a reservation based on the MAC address of a host. So in the DHCP server, we can go in and say, hey, if you receive a request from this particular MAC address, make sure to always assign this MAC address this specific IP address. So that essentially gives your host a static IP address that is configured from the server side. Now we can combine these two things, and we actually have to. Well, what's the point of having a scope? Well, let's say that we want to re reserve or keep a part of our network for reservations, we would say, hey, inside of the DHCP scope, only go 192.168.1.10 to 192.168.1.20 because we're going to use 192.168.1.21 all the way to 253 as a reservation space. And then you can configure your printers and your phones or whatever else is on the network to get the same IP address every single time, which helps with some advanced networking and some things that we're not going to talk about today. So that is it. That is how Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol works. Very important. Again, in the real world, you're really not going to see a server very many times. In larger networks, you can, and some older networks, you can as well. What you're most likely going to see is a router or a firewall have DHCP on it as a service. For example, on a pfSense firewall, you'll take DHCP and configure it on every single network interface you have, or you don't have to, but you can, and so on and so forth. So that's how that works. If you have any questions about that, please feel free to reach out to us at info@gensetech.com, and I appreciate you watching.